Thank you. It is so good to have you join with us each time, same time each week, and we do count it our real privilege to have you follow along in our Bible studies. We're now over here in Romans chapter 6, and the first four verses here have to deal with water baptism, and we're going to pick up where we left off last week, and that was with the baptism of the Lord Jesus Christ. We have some of those that project, well, Christ was baptized for our example so that we should be baptized. We find out at that particular time that the ordinance of baptism had not been given yet until after the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. But we find out, they say, well, we have some that say, well, he was baptized for his own sins. And we're going to look into the Word of God here and find out what it means when the Lord Jesus Christ was baptized. Why was he baptized? And we're going to look into that and continue from where we left off last week. So, first of all, if we examine this, we find out how that Christ's baptism fulfilled all righteousness. And if you'll notice, the Scripture says, all righteousness, not his righteousness, for we know our Lord Jesus Christ was sinless and remained sinless throughout his life. But let's get the verse back here now in Matthew chapter 3 and verses 13 to 15. And the last part of the verse here is the one we're going to examine here so that we know why the Lord Jesus Christ was baptized. Then cometh Jesus from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be baptized of him. But John forbid him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee. And comest thou to me? And Jesus answering said unto him, Suffer it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he suffered, or the word suffered means permitted him, to permit it, the Lord Jesus Christ. Now we know from the Word of God on the first proposal here that Christ was baptized for his sins. Well, we know that isn't true because we go to 2 Corinthians chapter 5 in verse 21, and the Word of God lets us know, For he hath made him, that's Christ, to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Now, since Jesus Christ was sinless, his baptism added nothing to his righteousness, for he was God manifested in human flesh. Therefore, since God's word is righteous and pure, the fulfillment of such would be the evidence. Now notice what Proverbs chapter 30 and verse 5 tells us. Every word of God is pure. The word pure means also righteous, pure, absolutely true. He is a shield unto them that put their trust in him. Now, God's word had prophesied of Christ's death in Psalms chapter 22 and verse 16. Also of his resurrection in Psalms chapter 16 in verse 10. Therefore, Christ's declaration of his identification by baptism proved God's word to be righteous, or we should say pure, which had promised of this some hundreds of years before it came to pass, fulfilling all righteousness, that is God's word, which spoke of his death, his burial, and his resurrection. So when Christ was baptized, it fulfilled what the Word of God had prophesied, which fulfilled the righteousness of the Word of God, that every Word of God is pure, every Word of God is righteous. Therefore, his baptism, pointing to the cross, was looked upon as though it was already accomplished, that is, his death, burial, and resurrection. That's why he stated to fulfill all righteousness, for the fulfillment of those prophecies was as good as done. That's the assurance that we have today in the sureness, the righteousness, the pureness of God's word. Let me ask you something. What are you trusting for your salvation? Are you trusting God's infallible word or the shallowness of man's ideologies? Notice in John chapter 5 and verse 24, Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. Now, we're going to study some other things here, and we're going over here and to begin to study, because not only do some say that therefore the Lord Jesus Christ was baptized for our example. He was baptized because he had sin, and that took care of his sin. Well, we find that is totally felonious to the Word of God. That is false teaching 100%. Then we find out, since he was not baptized for his own sins because he had no sin, We have those that project that, well, your baptism will wash away your sins. So it's going to be very interesting here as we begin to look at this. So we want to go over here and go with me here to Acts chapter 22 and verse 16. This is one of the sugar daddies of some of the denominations now, not many, but a few, that hold to the fact that your baptism will wash away your sins. Whenever you study the Word of God, it is so important to read the verses before it, read the whole chapter to get the context and not just extract one verse out. But this is one of their sugar daddies right here that is pulled out of context, as many other scriptures are, and try to build a false doctrine upon one scripture. And I might say this, this is why when you go to some of these liberal churches, the most scary thing to the preacher or the deacons or the elders is if you carry a Bible to church. That's the most scary thing in the world to them. They don't want you to do that, or they would encourage you to do that. And the reason is you may open your Bible and read all of the chapter, which will disprove them yanking one little verse out and trying to build upon the founder of their organization. Now let's go here to Acts chapter 22 and verse 16. And as I said, this is one of their sugar daddies that if you are ignorant enough just to sit there and never open your Bible and never read it, then you're going to be totally deceived. So we're going to get the context here and examine about Paul. Notice what this one verse says in Acts 22 and verse 16. It says, "And now, why tarriest thou? Arise and be baptized, and wash away thy sins, calling on the name of the Lord." So, if we read this one verse, if a person were to open their Bible and read just this one verse, one could only conclude that baptism was essential for salvation. But should a person desire to prove that the Bible says there is one God, or there is no God, I should say, one could locate such a statement. But should a person desire the truth of what God said, the whole verse or context should read, in this case, in Psalms 53:1, it reveals something to the contrary of just reading one line from one verse. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. Corrupt are they, and they've done abominable iniquity. There is none that doeth good. So you see how important it is to examine the context, which will always reveal the truth of a subject to the person who will be honest with themselves. So if you sit in church and the preacher opens the Bible, it'll usually be some book set down by the organization. And it will read, and this preacher would read, "And now, why tarriest thou? Arise and be baptized, wash away thy sins, calling on the name of the Lord." Close the book. Of course, you don't have a Bible now in church, so the only thing you know is one verse being quoted, and you're going to sit there and listen to all the philosophy now of the preacher to tell you why baptism is going to take you to heaven, which is a lie. Now, as we go on, we're going to find out here, as we've said, how important it is to examine the context, which will always reveal the truth of a subject if you want to be honest with yourself. The subject matter in question of which verse 16 is a part brings back and begins clear back in Acts chapter 21 and verse 15, where Paul goes to Jerusalem. It is here in the temple that the people apprehended Paul. Now we're going to back up, and we're going to take the context, the situation, where Paul was at, what happened to Paul, and why he said what he said. All right? Now, let's go back here to Acts chapter 21, verse 30. "And all the city was moved, and the people ran together, and they took Paul and drew him out of the temple, and forthwith the doors were shut." You see, Paul was not in the inner sanctuary, that is, in the Greek, the honeas, but only in the outer court, Tuherion. And they were beating Paul when he was saved by the chief captain and the soldiers in verse 32. And as they were leading him to the barracks of the Roman soldiers, that was the castle, Paul asked the chief captain for permission to speak to the people. And we find that, you can read it in verse 39 and 40 of the 21st chapter. His testimony is recorded in chapter 21 in verses 1 to 21. The same account is recorded by Dr. Luke in chapter 9 with more details in the book of Acts. Now, prior to Ananias instructing Paul to be baptized, we find that Paul was already saved. This is the importance of reading your Bible and studying it and not letting some preacher just take one verse and throw away the rest of the Bible without the context, the text, or the setting, or anything else. Now, as Paul was approaching Damascus, the Lord intervened and challenged Paul with these words. Follow with me now. Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou? I am Jesus of Nazareth, whom thou persecutest. And I, Paul, said, what shall I do, Lord? That was Paul's response. Paul's salvation is evidenced by his acknowledgement of Christ as his Lord and his Savior. And we find that here in chapter 22 here of the book of Acts here, and in verse 7, 8, and 10. It should also be noticed that Ananias called Saul a brother in chapter 22 in verse 13. Now, notice here, and let's read it. Ananias came unto me and stood. Now, Paul's giving his testimony of what happened back in Acts chapter 9. Ananias came unto me and stood and said unto me, Brother Saul, receive thy sight. At the same hour, I looked up upon him. Now, when you look at this, you need to understand what it says. You need to understand and read and digest what you read. Only the saved are spiritual brothers and sisters in Christ. And such was Saul. That's why he said unto him, Brother Saul, because Saul was a brother spiritually to him. He was already saved. Since Paul was already saved and addressed as a brother in Christ by Ananias, what did Ananias mean by telling Paul to be baptized and wash away thy sins, calling on the name of the Lord? In verse 16. Now, a person must remember that there is a judicial justification and a practical justification of sin. When Paul was saved, he received remission for all of his sins judicially. That is, the cross bore the eternal payment for Paul's sins. Now, let's notice this in Romans chapter 3, verse 24 and 25. Being justified, the word justified is a legal term, and it means declared absolutely righteous freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God has sent forth to be a propitiation, that is payment, through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. Now, Ananias was instructing Saul as to how to deal with his past sins practically and publicly. Every Jew and Gentile knew of Paul's commitment and his reputation concerning his pure persecution of Christians. Notice in Acts chapter 9, verse 1, And Saul, yet breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord. Notice in chapter 22 of the book of Acts, 19 and 20. Now, what we're giving you is the whole context around this situation to show you why that statement was made to be baptized and wash away thy sins. Remember, his sins were already washed away, or he would have not have been called by Ananias a brother, Brother Paul. Okay? Let's go. Now, notice here in Acts chapter 22 and verse 19 and 20, about Paul's past reputation. I imprisoned and I beat in every synagogue them that believed on thee, on Christ. And when the blood of thy martyr Stephen was shed, remember that? I was also standing by and consenting unto his death and kept the raiment of them that slew him. Paul hated Christians before he was saved. He was responsible for the killing of many Christians and the slaughtering of many Christians. Now that Paul's a Christian, his public profession of Christ is of the utmost importance. Now, I want to stop here for just a second, because this is why it's important to you. We have seen men saved that have been in jail, out of jail, on drugs, on many, many things. Their lives were an absolute wreck. And yet, when God saved them, and they knew that they had eternal life, they were baptized, and it was a shock to many, many people that, hey, this fella is now going to church. She, who lived an immoral life, she's saved now. She's going to church. She's not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, and she's water baptized, identifying herself with Jesus Christ, same as the man and anyone. And therefore, it is quite a shock, and it is a testimony. I'm not going to do the things and live the kind of life that I lived in the past. I'm a new creation in Christ Jesus now, and I want to walk the way the Lord wants me to walk. Now, his baptism, that is Paul's, would be a public testimony of his faith in the death, the burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. With his baptism, he was now publicly identifying himself with those Christians that he now once persecuted. The sins of Paul was going to wash away were his acts of persecution against Christians prior to being saved. Let me say it again. The sins Paul was going to wash away by his baptism in the eyes of those who were watching were his acts of persecution against Christians prior to being saved. He would never do those sins again because he was now a Christian himself. His baptism identified himself with Jesus Christ. He was not persecuting and killing Christians now. He was not persecuting Christ, but he was now a part of Christ. He was one of God's children now. So his water baptism was a public testimony that he would never commit those acts again. Judicially, Paul's sins were judged upon Calvary. Now they would be washed away, get this now, publicly in the eyes of the Christians who knew of his conversion, made public by his baptism. Now you can rest assured, Paul gave his testimony at his baptism by calling on the name of the Lord. The sins of Paul's persecutions against Christians would never be repeated again. His public profession from that time on washed away any doubt of those sins ever being repeated. God had taken a murderer and made of him a missionary. He had turned a persecutor into a preacher, and he used him to write 14 of the 27 books of the New Testament. Yes, judicially, Paul's sins were accounted paid in full at the cross. Publicly, they were washed away, as there remained no doubt in people's minds as to where he stood, remaining faithful to his Lord until his death. Baptism, after you're saved, is a public testimony to all of the public watching that you are raised with him and you're going to walk in newness of life. The old person, the old type of person that you were, you're not going to yell and scream and rant and rave and cuss and swear and all that sort of thing. You're water baptized now. You're identifying yourself that you're a son of God. You're a child of God. You belong to the Lord Jesus Christ. You most assuredly do. And now, by your public profession of water baptized, being water baptized, you're letting people know that you now, being a Christian, that you're not going to commit those sins again anymore. I remember when I was just a teenager in high school, I thought it was so smart. And if I would see a kid that would carry a Bible or thought that he was a Christian, I would go up and pick a fight with him. And I wanted to disgrace him. I wanted to make him ashamed and show him I was the big shot. I wasn't any sissy walking around carrying a Bible and so forth. But I'll tell you this, after I trusted Jesus Christ as my Savior, I wish I had some of that to do over again. But when I was water baptized, it was a public testimony that I would never pick another fight with another Christian. I was going to change and live the kind of life that Jesus Christ wanted me to live. Now, I want to go on to something else, because also, while we're on this section here in Romans chapter 6, we find out again that there are those that say, well, yes, you know, that the whole household was baptized, therefore, it includes babies and so forth like that. So we want to cover that just a little bit, because this is the damnable error that has misled so many people right straight into hell, and that is by promoting baptism as part of salvation, or that your baptism is going to take you to heaven, which it does not. It is only your public testimony. So I want to take you to some of the places that some of these people use that I've experienced in 30 years, and they always run to this. I was up north, and I stopped into a particular, I happened to see a man out on the churchyard, and I stopped and asked him if he knew where the pastor was at. He said, I am the pastor. And I said, well, could I speak with you a few minutes? Do you have a few minutes? He said, I need a break. Come on in. We went into his office, and I knew this particular denomination that they baptized babies. And I began to ask him about that. I said, would you show me anywhere in the Bible where babies are to be baptized and why that you do that? And he was including them into the household of some of these that we're going to discover here. And when I said, let's turn in our Bible and see, and you will find no babies anywhere here. Well, he became very embarrassed, and he didn't think there was anything wrong with it, but there was no place in the Bible he could find it. But the church has done it all this time, and it makes the people feel good. In other words, he was a damnable false teacher. It didn't make any difference what God said in the Bible. It just made people feel good, and it cemented them into their church. And as long as he made them feel good, it didn't matter if he lied to them about baptizing babies or whether he did not. He didn't care about that at all. He just cared about getting people into his church and making them feel good, and they would be happy. So we're going here now, and we're going to examine some of these. The reasoning, as we've said, of many is that if a whole household is baptized, it must include babies also. So we're going to examine some of the errors that are projected, cited, as we're going to do right now, are some of the passages which are used. First of all, go with me in your Bible to Acts chapter 16, verse 15. We come over here to verse 15, and here's what we find. And when she, that's Lydia, was baptized, and her household, she besought us, saying, if you have judged me faithful to the Lord, come into my house and abide there. And she constrained us. She wanted them to come in. Now, on the part of those who endorse infant baptism, it is presupposed that her household included a baby or babies. Yet, God's word contains no such account. This is adding to the word of God. And this is one of the places that this particular preacher wanted me, or I should say not wanted me to go to, but he threw out to me. And when I wanted him to go and turn in the Bible, and he eventually did, I said, where do you find babies anywhere? Why did you make it up? You didn't know Lydia. And if there had been babies to be baptized, God would have put it in the Bible. Well, he became very embarrassed, and he didn't have much time to talk after that. And I said, if you ever find the verse in there where babies to be baptized, would you write me? Well, I knew he never would. I've done that to several preachers, and you'll never find it at all. It's all a bunch of double talk and a bunch of adding to the Word of God. And the Bible says in Proverbs chapter 30, verse 6, add thou not unto his words, lest he reprove thee, and thou be found a liar. So we come on down, and we find out here. He presupposed that it included a baby or babies, yet nowhere in the Word of God did it contain any such account. There is no record of Lydia's being married even, being a mother, or having children in her home. Nothing ever said about that. We are told that after Paul and Silas left Lydia's house, they were beaten and put in prison, and upon the release, they returned to Lydia's house, and we found out who composed the household. Now, the record's given in Acts chapter 16, verse 40. Read the next verse. Read the context. And this is what churches that propose this damnable stuff never want you to do. They do not. The greatest thing liberal churches hate is for you to carry a Bible to church. Stay away from the preacher that preaches the Bible that contradicts what we've practiced for years, invented by the man who founded their organization. So they're scared to death. And don't get around Pastor Younce now. After all, he'll contaminate you. Yeah, he surely will with the Word of God and expose this false teaching of babies being baptized. Let's go here to Acts chapter 16, verse 40, concerning Lydia. And they, Paul and Silas, went out of the prison, and they entered into the house of Lydia. And when they had seen the brethren, they comforted them and departed. These brethren, as spoken of in verse 15, made up the household of Lydia. She'd have given them free lodging, or she could have charged them for the lodging. We don't know. We simply do not know. But her household in verse 15 does not necessarily mean her own family. We're not told. But from the record now that we have, it would be inclusive of all that were lodging in her home. She no doubt was a wonderful woman, which from verse 40 would have been the brethren. These were the ones baptized along with Lydia in verse 15 and spoken of as her household. Again, the prerequisite for baptism is acceptance of Christ as Savior, and such was the case with Lydia. She heard Paul's words and believed. Notice in verse 14, she, Lydia, attended unto the things which were spoken of Paul. Then she was baptized. Her household, as the brethren in verse 40 were called, shows that they were saved and then baptized. Paul never baptized anyone to be saved or before they were saved, only those who were already saved. So when you hear a church that uses Lydia, read the whole chapter and throw it right back into their face. There were no babies here whatsoever. Now, let's go to the jailer's household. We'd like for you to go in your Bibles now. We're going to examine another place that is used many times, and I see our time's gone. So we're going to have to stop right here. But we're taking a little bit of time on this because it's one of the most damnable false doctrines ever perpetrated upon mankind to slip them right into hell, sidestepping the Lord Jesus Christ and his finished work. Now, many of these organizations say, yes, we believe that Jesus died and how wonderful he is and so forth, but they don't really believe that, because if they did, they would never tell you you have to be baptized. When Christ said it's finished, he didn't say it's finished, but you have to finish it up for me and be water baptized. He never said that at all. Salvation is by grace through faith plus nothing, and it does not include water baptism. I might say this to you. What are you trusting? I hope you're trusting the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ that was shed upon the cross of Calvary. God loved the world, gave his only begotten Son. Whosoever believeth in him would never perish but have everlasting life. We'll continue on this next week. We'd like for you to visit our website. It's www.heritagebbc.com. You'll love it. We get so many. I think the first day of March, the man who runs it told us we had something like 9,000 visits in one day. That's unheard of. That's far expands anything I could ever imagine, but it's worldwide, and we get a lot of that. Well, we hope you'll take time to write. Our mailing address is the Heritage Radio Bible Class, Post Office Box 573, Walnut Grove, Minnesota, and our zip code is 56180. Until next week at the same time, may the Lord richly bless you as we ever pray. Even so, come, Lord Jesus.